welcome to Chairside Live. I'm Megan Strong.
And I'm Will Schmidt, registered dental assistant here at Gladwell Dental.
And as the registered dental assistant, you often give us cases for across the chair. And I hear you've got a good one for us today. You're taking it back to the BioTemps embrasure case. That's that good old three-unit BioTemps bridge. And now you're talking Pontics.
Megan, did you know that on our prescription forms, we have an area where doctors can actually designate what Pontic design that they want?
We do?
We absolutely do. And do you know, take a wild guess, who in the laboratory is designing these Pontics if the doctor doesn't communicate?
The Elvis Presley.
Exactly. The lab technician, having never seen this patient before, is designing these Pontics. And we have some really neat ideas for Pontic designs, and I think doctors should know.
Okay, and I know artificial intelligence plays a role in trimming the models. So, I mean, call Will Smith. Is this iRobot?
It really is. And Megan, you and I, in fact, are in danger of being replaced by robots hosting this very show.
Don't tell me.
But all joking aside, Jim Gladwell is very proud of artificial intelligence and how accurately our restorations are being designed in the lab instead of being hand-designed these days. This gives doctors the perfect platform to have a perfect, well-fit restoration every time, as long as the communication is there.
Okay, let's see your case.
Well, recently I presented a Chairside Live video about techniques that I use when preparing healthy embrasures for BioTemps. Now, you can find the link to that episode floating around on the screen somewhere if you'd like to use it to catch up on today's talk. I used a three-unit BioTemp bridge for that demonstration, and as I watched the video back myself, I started to think about the actual design of the bridge pontic, and I realized that for as much as I was promoting the opening of the embrasures and cleansability, I noticed that the pontic design itself might not have been the best ideal shape to promote healing and long-term success of the eventual final restoration and its aesthetics. This gets me thinking more about informed choices that we are able to make chairside with the patient right in front of us, but also our willingness to share this information with the dental lab. Interestingly enough, it's usually the lab technicians who are designing pontics. In fact, discussions about pontic design happen pretty routinely in the lab. The tech gets the model work or the scan and then has to wonder exactly what type of pontic they are supposed to design. Now, I'm employed full-time in the lab environment, so I know firsthand that it is a common occurrence for the design to not be chosen on the prescription form despite the existence of a checkbox for it. Even if one of these boxes is checked, it's even less likely that additional information is provided. So, take for instance the pontic design on this three-unit BioTemp bridge. Now remember, this is the same bridge that I talked about in my last episode. And when I turn it around, you can see the appearance of a ridge lap pontic design. It's also called a saddle ridge lap because it looks like a riding saddle that's worn over the back of a horse. It's a fairly aesthetic design from any angle, but its major flaw is its lack of cleansability, and it often results in irritated tissue. In fact, most dentists that I've talked to about this tell me that they absolutely do not use saddle ridge lap pontics in their practice, nor do they even consider them as an option. An option that is more commonly used instead of the full saddle ridge lap pontic design is what is known as a modified ridge lap. This pontic is shaped so that the saddle laps over the buckle side only. The shape and size of the ridge and restoration dictate the lingual design, but it does curve in to leave the lingual ridge exposed. This is fairly aesthetic and more cleansable than the full ridge lap. Since the purpose of today's video is to create a clearer line of communication between the practice and the lab, an important feature to discuss about modified ridge lap designs is exactly where and by how much should the lingual be adjusted according to this specific patient's ridge. So, let's take a look at a few more options at your disposal. The ovate pontic design is ideal for the anterior. However, it's not limited and can be used for posteriors because it is highly aesthetic and low maintenance. This design creates a bit of a depression or an indentation in the residual tissue ridge so that it mimics the shape of a natural root and crown. Now, the pontic looks like it's growing out of the gum tissue and just not resting on top of it. So what if your lab tech, having been given little to no design instruction on the prescription, shapes an ovate pontic because they think it will look the best? Are you sure this is going to seat? Would you be comfortable modifying the tissue intraorally to match the amount that was trimmed out of the cast? Or would a trial or training period in a provisional with an ovate design be more appropriate? This affords you the ability to carefully treatment plan over time and make an informed decision on the lab prescription by specifying details for a more predictable final bridge. Playing off of the shape of the ovate design, a conical pontic, also called egg shape, bullet-shaped, or even heart-shaped, has only one point of contact at the center of the residual ridge, but it does not depress into it, as the ovate design usually will. It should be made as convex as possible, and this makes it easy for the patient to clean. This design is recommended more for replacing mandibular posterior areas where aesthetics are less of a concern. The final design I'd like to talk about today is the hygienic, also called sanitary, pontic. This design is easily cleansable and ideal for the health of the tissue, especially new surgical sites. However, it is not at all aesthetic. It could lead to food entrapment and can become annoying to the tongue over time. It is fabricated to have zero tissue contact, sometimes 2 to 3 millimeters of space. In fact, it is traditionally shaped convex to match the tissue it spans. This shape is loosely known as a fish belly. It can also be modified to shape the gingival portion concave to resemble sort of an archway between the retainers. This allows for increased connector size and decreased stress during load bearing. These differences make it seem like the hygienic design contradicts itself, from concave to convex and fish bellies to fixed arcs. The design parameters can become elaborate and even confusing. Keep in mind that you are doing your lab tech and your patient the best service by specifically addressing these important issues. Doctors and assistants should all run through a mental checklist of 4 very basic standards of design. First, the tissue surface of the pontic should be shaped for ease of cleaning. Second, pontics should never have positive pressure on the underlying tissue unless they are meant exclusively for provisional shaping. Third, pontics and connectors must be built to withstand occlusal forces. Finally, pontics should restore aesthetics. Here's to your success with future treatments. Thank you so much for watching.
Well, thank you for that, Will. That was awesome.
Not a problem, Megan. I hope this bridged the gap between the dental practice and the lab when talking about communicating pontic designs.
I think it did just that. Well, that wraps it up for this episode of Chairside Live. On behalf of everyone here at Glidewell Dental, thank you so much for watching.
And we'll meet you right back here next time.